Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for attending my talk. My name's Dave West. I'll come back to the Mark Twain quote. It's a quote that Ken Schwaber, my boss, really likes to use on every one of his training classes, because sometimes on a training class with Ken, it definitely feels like you're eating a live frog. So who am I? So I'm the product owner at scrum.org. Now, we'll talk a little bit about who scrum.org is in a moment, but the chairman of the board at scrum.org is Ken Schwaber. So I report to Ken, but I haven't always been the product owner at scrum.org. I was the chief product officer at a startup called TaskTop. We grew to about 100 people. I had 7 scrum teams delivering working software. I was an analyst and research director at Forrester Research before that, and I have to admit it, I developed something called the Rational Unified Process. Now, no booing, please. The RUP is obviously a part of our history. We made lots of mistakes, but we also learned lots of things. It was part of our evolution to maturity, I hope. And I have certainly lots of experience that I can share if anybody's got any comments on the Rational Unified Process. As you can see, though, really what I am is a dad. Now, that's me and my son, George, at the top, doing a very important sprint review. As you can see from the background, there's a garage that we just built, and I'm reviewing it with a key stakeholder, George, who's probably the most honest stakeholder I've ever worked with. Now, Harry, the one below, is 10 weeks old. Now, the great thing about having a 10-week-old at home is when you have jet lag, it feels nothing in comparison to having a 10-week-old at home. You're like, really? I can go to sleep? There's no crying? There's no grumpy wife? It's brilliant. Well, there is a grumpy wife, but luckily the internet's not fabulous in the hotel, so she doesn't get to talk to me that often. And some contact details there. Now, as you can tell from my accent, I'm from the United Kingdom, from England, but I live in America. So that means that I've become a little bit, my grand describes it as mid-Atlantic. So I may use words that nobody understands. I may possibly start sort of being half American, half English in my responses. I apologize. I understand that, you know, this might be a little confusing. So please bear with me or stop me and ask me what I'm going on about. The other thing is I like to have a little bit of fun as we present this stuff. It's 5:30, which is drinking time, so I'm surprised I'm actually sober on this stage. But so let's have some fun as we go through these slides. As we talk a little bit about Scrum, about its future, about its past, about its lineage, about some of its challenges today, and how we can make that real in organizations, and some things that you guys can think about helping us to improve in the Scrum community. So I work in an organization with a guy called Ken Schwaber. Ken, chairman of the board, Ken Schwaber, has sort of had an interesting journey to scrum.org. In 2001, after they signed the Agile Manifesto, he found that loads of people were emailing him and the other signatories asking to be part of the Agile Manifesto, and they had no organization concept or structure. Interestingly, the Rational Unified Process team wasn't emailing them. It turns out that was a bit of a mistake. And so he created and drove the creation of the Agile Alliance. Now, the Agile Alliance is really known for one big event, right, once a year. But it was inspired not to do that. It was started to create community, to actually take things like Scrum, XP, and other things that were really key at that time, and drive that and develop it and improve it. Unfortunately, it didn't really work out like that. So in 2004, Ken realized that people like to make money and deliver value and build businesses around this agile thing. That's part of its success. And he created Scrum Alliance. Now, he created a very viable organization that a lot of you have been part of with Scrum Alliance. In 2009, though, he decided that he didn't like the world of work and instead wanted to focus purely on software development and purely on some of the principles that he was developing at scrum.org. And he created scrum.org. That's the organization that I'm in, that I run. And when I talk to you a little bit about Scrum, scrum.org is really driving a lot of the content and ideas around Scrum. So I'm going to share some of those with you. It has a very simple mission. Interestingly, scrum.org's mission has nothing to do with Scrum. And that really is Ken. Ken was like, yeah, we just called it Scrum, and I'll explain why later. That's not what I care about. What I care about, really, what's very important to me, is actually the profession of software development. He's very, very worried. At heart, he's worried that we're going to be legislated, that we're going to be somehow a series of practices and instruments are going to be applied to us because we're going to build cars that don't actually deliver on the mileage that they're meant to, like some large German organization did. Software did that. What happens when the first pacemaker is hacked badly and kills somebody? It's probably happened, but we just don't know about it. And he's really worried about the profession. He believes Scrum and empirical management is key to ensuring our profession improves. So he built an organization called scrum.org, which is the home of Scrum. Now, Scrum is used, how many people use Scrum in this room? Wow, and the others are obviously asleep. But the Scrum, 90%, that's pretty much 90%. 90% of Agile teams are using Scrum today. And that's probably, that's a Forrester piece of data. You know, there's a significant number of people every day applying those practices, those 11 things that Scrum's made of, every day on their day-to-day work, delivering amazing software. Scrum.org is heavily involved in this community. These are some stats. I'm going to bore you with that. What is impressive, though, and I get impressed every month with that number of classes, a number of human beings that interact with us every month that are interested in assessments, training, and being part of the community. It's really, really, really exciting. And it's being practiced everywhere. Vietnam, one of the recent translations of the Nexus, and we'll talk a little bit about scaled Scrum in a little while. One of the recent translations of the Nexus, Vietnamese. There's a guy doing some really strange like language I'd never heard of that's only spoken by Eskimos because he decides that it's important. It's incredible, the reach of Scrum across the world. But it hasn't always been like that, has it? Now I'm going to take you back 22, 25 years ago for the people that weren't using RUP, or maybe they were using RUP. Remember those days? Remember the days when work used to be decided on by a small group of people sitting in a nice ivory tower, usually wearing suits? I remember my first job out of university, the guys used to phone down when you could take your jacket off. Of course, everybody had taken their jackets off and you put them on when they reappeared, but that was the kind of world that we lived in. And they decided their needs. It would be business analysts would talk to them, maybe if they're very lucky, or talk to somebody that talked to them. Those requirements would be grouped up and then delivered. This waterfall life cycle. Interestingly, waterfall was a term coined by a guy called Winston Royce. And he described it as not the ideal way of building software. But just like all these things, the term, somebody briefly read the white paper probably, you know, like we all do because we're far too busy with diapers, or maybe that's just me. One hand diaper, other hand software. That's my pretty much my mission in life at the moment. But somebody just read it briefly and said, oh, waterfall, doesn't that sound good? And obviously then the whole idea of management practices and waterfall came off. But these waterfall practices were very much in 21 years ago, were very much happening. But then the types of projects changed. We weren't just automating business processes. We weren't just taking things that were manual and making them electronic. We started to look at opportunities to use software in very different ways. Innovation started to be driven by software. It started to be driven by our ability to do things in very different ways that you can't actually do manually. Isn't that incredible that a lot of our businesses that you guys work in every day, if there wasn't computers, there wouldn't be a business. Imagine if the computer stopped working, what the CEO of Uber would do. He'd be like, well, I can't even surf the internet and check my Facebook friends. But, you know, he'd have nothing, as Airbnb would have nothing. In fact, most organizations would have very little. And he would end up going back to some pre-civilization age, you know, when computers didn't exist. But the ultimate idea was that opportunities and this level of complexity, this innovation, drove a very different kind of problem space. A problem space that was very hard to really nail down in a very long Word document that you that was presented to you once a year by a very disgruntled requirements guy who just worked with a business guy who didn't really care about technology at all. So we started to see a model that looked a bit like this, where complexity of requirements and technical understanding grew. And that led us to a different way of delivering software. That problem, these situations led us to applying a different set of ideas, because traditional techniques and technology and tools that were really being applied to it, they were applying robots to it, they were applying, you know, not literally, but the idea, they were applying software, tools like use cases, requirements, formal specifications. Remember Z, a mechanism of using mathematics to express functional requirements? Wow, that was deep, man. You know, I mean, totally complicated stuff. But they didn't help. They didn't solve it. So there was a new way. So Ken and Jeff stumbled upon this HPR article by two Japanese gentlemen that names are totally unpronounceable by me. I apologize. And they wrote a paper that's probably the start of it all, really. I mean, there's probably many starts. It's like, you know, they're always trying to find the start of humans. And they're like, you know, they got Eve, and they're like, but there's probably an Eve 2 and an Eve 3 and an Eve 4. So there's probably multiple starts, but this is definitely one of them. And they did this analysis as part of their doctoral thesis, as part of the research at Harvard Business School. They went and looked at these organizations that were doing very innovative product development. They were building cars, for instance, that were fundamentally different, this was Honda, to anything on the road. Remember that car that was very boxed in the 80s, when all the other cars were sort of like round and odd looking? And this box car came out, and they're like, why is that? Is that because people wear big hats? Apparently not. It was a very successful town car. Apparently people like to drive around in towns, not in Bangalore. You just seem to like to stand there waiting as thousands of things happen, but you're in a car. Well, the Honda was one of them, 3M was another, and a number of organizations they looked at, and they found these six characteristics that were very consistent in these organizations. Built-in instability. They actually just told people what the goal was, told these teams what the goal was, but didn't tell them how to get there. So they were very dynamic of how they were doing it. Self-organizing teams. Autonomy, pushing the limits, cross-functional teams where lots of skills are in there. Overlapping development phases, dare we call those sprints or iterations. Multi-learning, so the idea that learn by doing rather than by reading about it. You actually built hypotheses and delivered it to market and got feedback. Experiments were at the heart of it. Minor process controls, so very little governance, very light checkpoints, maybe at the end of each iteration or sprint. Organizational transfer of learning, the idea that they're a learning organization, that fifth discipline that we talked about in the early keynote yesterday. They built these ideas out and they created teams that were very driven. And bizarrely, considering that these two gentlemen were Japanese and they're not really famous for rugby, they used terms scrum and rugby in this paper. How bizarre, though they actually have got Japan has got a rugby team. It's not awfully good, but they do have one. And so that was a better way. Now those ideas were distilled, and there was a long journey of distillation and experimentation by Jeff and Ken. You may have heard of the FBI Sentinel Project, a key project that sort of like codified some of these ideas. And they're described in something called the Scrum Guide. The Scrum Guide is a definitive body of knowledge around Scrum. So it must be huge, right? It must be a telephone book. It must be incredibly complex, like the RUP was. Because Scrum is being used by everyone and people are using it to build software. No, it's actually less than 20 pages. You can read it on the toilet, so without staying in the toilet all day. Not that I'm implying that you should be staying in the toilet. I don't know why I said that. But you could if you wanted to. In fact, I recommend that you print it out, staple it together, and put it by your loo. You never know who could learn Scrum. You don't. You really, really don't. You can imagine your wife, what is this rubbish? Where's Homes and Garden? That's the Scrum Guide, hun. That's what I do. You do Scrum? You play rugby? No. And so the Scrum Guide, definitive definition of some very interesting process, a very lightweight process, a process that concentrates on delivering working software frequently, a process that has very simple roles, three, has a very simple meetings, three, has simple mechanisms. that brings everything together. The idea of a sprint that can be up to 4 weeks, you can, but not doesn't have to be. The idea is that you have a daily scrum based on the idea of a stand-up, where you stand up and don't necessarily stand up, actually. Ken doesn't believe in standing up. He shouts at you if you do, so don't. And if you call it a stand-up, you have to stand in the corner for an hour. So we do, and we're in the cone of non-scrum. No, not actually. I was going to say not really, but kind of really. The idea that you have a self-organizing, self-managed team, a team that's led and coached and helped by somebody called a scrum master. Interestingly, Ken and Jeff both think that that was a misterm. They shouldn't have used the word scrum master. I think the popularity of the process, having the word master in it, everybody wants to be a master, hey? Kung fu fighting and all that. I know I do, even though it looked a bit like I was doing disco then. The scrum master, the key role, that idea of the scrum master was probably the most popular thing and why it became so popular. If we'd have put scrum master in the RUP, we'd be at a RUP conference now, I've decided. I don't know if that's true, but I always pretend that that's true. So the idea is that this framework, not a method, method implies a level of rigor and prescription that this is not. This is a series of, this is a structure, a set of ideas, a framework. In the same way as you build a frame of a tent and then you have to put the tent around it, it's a framework that allows you to build software in an effective way, allows teams to build software in an effective way. And that's an important focus. It's very much focused on teams, allowing teams to deliver working software. And it's become incredibly successful. You saw the 90% stat from Forrester. Over 500,000 people trained in it. 500,000 people. And that's just the ones that we actually take records at Scrum Alliance and Scrum.org. There's probably 1 million people, actually, that have ultimately been trained in it. It's broke out of just software development, and it's applying in all sorts of areas now. But just in software development, 500,000 people have been trained in it. There's over 100 books. I say over 100 books because I was trying to count them, and I stopped being able to count when I got my Texas Instruments calculator. And so at 100, I gave up. I was like, geez, there's a lot of books here. With Scrum in the title, not just in the content, but in the title. And let's be frank, if you go and look at Scaled Agile Framework, you look at LESS, you look at DAD, Disciplined Agile, you look at these processes, and at the heart of it, not exclusively, but for the lot of their implementation, Scrum sits there. Scrum is at the heart of every approach that we do today. And the Scrum Guide is open, public, you know, commons license, you can just use it. It's available, it's free, anybody can pick it up, anybody can use it today. And it's 21 years old. It's not quite 21 years old, it's almost 21 years old because it was the summer, but it's almost 21 years old. It's just getting ready to drink in America, so it's about to get really nasty. And who knows what's going to happen. You know, we've given it a curfew, we're not letting it text whilst driving. But it's almost 21 years old. So it's time to celebrate. I'm wearing my dancing shirt that doesn't show the sweat. So I think we should celebrate. I think we should rejoice in this moment where Scrum has become popular. It's driven agility into the enterprise. Teams are doing it, building great software every day. It's time to celebrate. Yeah, no. Jim Johnson, Chaos Report. Very important. I don't know if you're all familiar with Jim Johnson. He writes this thing called the Chaos Report. It comes out every year. He looks at success, challenged, and failed projects. There's a lot of great data under this. This is just the sort of like headlines, and it's not quite as bad as it looks, I'll be honest. But look at this. We still have a lot of failed projects. Yes, that number's dropped from 2011. It does this every year for some reason. But we still have a ridiculously amount of challenged projects. We still have a lot of unsuccessful projects. If you look at the data, what you see is Agile is actually a lot more successful. So that's good, but not perfect. And you also see that small projects are much more successful than large projects. No shit, Sherlock. In small projects are an absolute nightmare. We all know that. It's like trying to marshal cats, or in my case, small children. You get 5 small children in a room, I have no idea. You just have to just step back and hope there's nothing breakable in there. And that's true of most large software projects from my experience. Step back and don't give them anything that's sharp. So it's not so great. And then there's this consistency problem that really worries me. It worries me so much I used a black and white photo, which is always serious. If you ask 20 Scrum Masters what should be in a backlog, and this is just an example, what should be in the backlog? You'd get 21 answers. Why? Because you know what Scrum Masters are like. Eh? They always have a couple of ideas, particularly consultant Scrum Masters. Each consultant comes with his or her bag of tricks around and their version of Scrum. Well, what I see, I like to do a daily stand-up standing on one leg. Find that key part of Scrum. Don't, you know, it's really good, good for yoga, good for posture as well, you know. Sitting is the new smoking. Standing on two legs is the new cigar smoking. I don't know. And they come with their own particular version of Scrum that's unique to them. And some companies have taken this Scrum, added it to their framework, built really, really big posters. Nothing wrong with posters. Rupp had a fabulous poster. I almost got a tattoo of it. Glad I didn't, turns out. But, you know, built these huge posters and huge documents that describe how they implement Scrum. Thousands of pages of Scrum. That's a bit worrying, isn't it? So we've got a large amount of failed projects, and we've got an inconsistent implementation of Scrum. And then there's water Scrum fall. Now, as an analyst at Forrester Research, we used to do gigs like this all the time. I was actually good at speaking then. I'm a bit out of practice, sorry if I'm a bit rusty. And I remember I was delivering this presentation around the growth of Agile in the enterprise. I was very excited. I was up there. Obviously, I was wearing a suit. I was an analyst. I'd been carried in by two guys, you know, on poles. I was very treated, and I was going to a five-star restaurant that night. That's the life of an analyst. It's brilliant. Why did I leave? No idea. Anyway, so, and I was doing this presentation. I mean, it was going very well. I hadn't offended anybody, because there was no Scottish people in the room. And we'd got a situation where I was talking about statistics about Agile adoption, and I made an offhand comment about 60% of new projects are Agile. And the guy said, yeah, I don't believe you. He was probably a tester. Not sure why we let them out, but he was out there anyway. And he was standing in the front, and he asked me, prove it. And I talked about methodology. I talked about how we gathered that information. And basically, I BS'd him because I didn't know. I'd done a survey where I'd asked some questions around Agile adoption, but I didn't really know. So we did a massive undertaking. You know, we interviewed, we researched, we talked to lots of organizations about really what they were doing. We also used a survey as well. And we found the majority of organizations were doing something that wasn't really that agile. It was something that was kind of agile, but. I could have called it Scrum but, I could have called it anything, but I coined the term water Scrum fall. You know, there was a large planning process that was mystical and magical, and there was thousands of people were sometimes used, or one, depending on the organization, and it created these huge Gantt charts and project IDs and all sorts of stuff. Then people actually worked as Scrum, and there was different levels of maturity and how good they were, and we'll talk about some of those things. But it was, you know, they were using Scrum. And then occasionally, when it couldn't be avoided, software is released. It escaped, actually. I don't think it released. You know, releasing sounds like there was some very formal, like, intelligent, good process. It really wasn't. It just, the smell overwhelmed the people, and somebody had to get it out of the building. And that's what I call fall. Water Scrum fall. Water Scrum fall was the predominant way people were building software. That's a worrisome trend. Really, really dangerous and really, really bad. So, okay. So Scrum's been really successful, though. So I don't like to disappoint you. I'm still going to have a party tonight. I'm still going to get excited. I might even do some disco dancing or what that bang or whatever it is, the Indian dancing, which looks very exciting if you've got lots of friends. It must be quite lonely to do it on your own. But really, let's not get too disappointed, but there is definitely some opportunities for the next 20 years as Scrum gets out of the car. It can now drive, can go out into the world. What sort of things do we need to think about and we need to improve? Some of these things are things that we at scrum.org are doing, the community of professional Scrum trainers, the community of some of our friendly organizations and academic institutions around the world are thinking about. And some of them are things that you should think about. And I highlighted four broad things that we should focus on. One is around measurement. One thing that Scrum doesn't really provide us with is any real defined set of measures. In fact, people often think that Scrum is all about measuring velocity. It really isn't. It's about delivering working software, getting review of that, getting that feedback into the process and responding to change. It's about agility. It's not about managing processes and getting data from that. But we need to think a little bit about measuring. We need to think about providing an environment around Scrum that really allows us to focus on the things that are important, that helps us get away from water Scrum 4 because our data is telling us that that isn't good for us. When you think about the people doing Scrum, we need to think about professionalism, we need to think about getting, stepping back from the intellectual showing off that is so easy to do in our community. You know, that you called it a tomato. Well, I won't call it a tomato. I'm going to call it a tomato because that makes me sound smarter. Obviously, I'm English, so I am. But the point is, hey, come on, guys. We did invent cricket, and then you guys play it better than us. We did invent the English language, and America uses it more than us. But apart from that, we invented lots of industries that everybody else is better at than us. Yeah. Anyway, so the point is, you know, we need to improve the professionalism. We need to step back from the BS and actually start doing things in a more professional way. We need to start thinking about how we do that, how we measure that, how we ensure that we're being professional, the values that we drive. We need to broaden the support for done. Done. There was a really good presentation that kicked all this off about joy and about the developers seem to have more phrases for done than Eskimos have for snow. That's a real problem in our industry. You know, how many organizations deliver working software that's potentially shippable at the end of each sprint? Well, no, I can't do that, can I? I mean, come on. I'm Citibank, I'm Bank of America, I'm this, I'm that. No, there's all sorts of, you don't understand the complexity. No, guys. You don't understand what agility is. It's about getting software out frequently. It's about observing that behavior. It's about delivering value to your customers as fast as possible. And it's about building infrastructure and systems and processes that allow us to do that. It's about getting stuff out because we don't know what stuff really people want. We don't know. We need that feedback. We need to respond to the environment. You can't pretend. You can't fake it anymore. It's an embarrassment. Now, obviously, it could be a staged approach. We could slowly get there. It could be an aspiration that we're all striving for every day. But we need to think about done a little bit more. And when you think about scaling Scrum, and I don't mean scaling like safe. It's a very different scaling. One of the biggest mistakes or misunderstandings around Scrum is when you've got multiple Scrum teams working on the same endeavor, working on the same project, working on the same product. I don't like to use the word project word, but I did just to appease a few people in the room. The idea is when you've got these multiple teams. So Ken always thought that Scrum would work brilliantly there, and the mechanisms that were in the core framework were fine for that, but unfortunately they weren't. Well, they weren't well understood, so how do we add a little bit of rigor for delivery, scaling delivery, not portfolio management, not release management, not enterprise architecture, not systems engineering, not all the other stuff, the value stream stuff, the business analytics, all that, no. Just concentrating on Scrum, it's still Scrum. But how do we make that a little bit more formal? I'm gonna talk through these four things and see where they take us. Let's start with that measurement stuff. How do we really understand how well we're doing? Well, it's how many people have been through training, isn't it? And got PSM or some other assessment. It's how many people have attended the Scrum class or the Agile class or the Safe class or whatever. That's how we measure success. It's burn down. It's all about burn down. If our line is like this, then we're all good, right? If it doesn't move, you're probably lying. If it doesn't move in terms of its gradient, that's brilliant. Burn down. Defect density, that's the way. No, that isn't the way you measure our success. Scrum and Agile is about delivering business software. It's about delivering value to a customer, a stakeholder, an end user. It's about delivering value. So we have to understand that in some context. And it's not just value for today, it's also value for tomorrow. And it's how often we do that. So the three things that we concentrate on when we're talking about this. Now, there's a lot of ideas. This isn't perfect, it isn't complete, but is this idea of EBM, evidence-based management. The idea that we can measure three main sort of collections of things. Current value, like how much value are we getting, what revenue, what product cost ratios, employee satisfaction, customer satisfaction, some sort of value thing that makes sense. Ability to innovate. How often do we get the usage? How often we change stuff? How frequently we deliver stuff? How often people are changing? Now that Windows example of Vista, that's the ultimate anti. That's a negative number on installed. You had more people on a previous version, now everybody's gone back because it was a disaster. That's probably not good. How often do we innovate? How often do we get quality products? How many defects do we find? What sort of density do we find? And then time to market. Time to market is crucial in this world because organizations often without the inertia and the legacy of some of the companies you work for are delivering software much faster than you can possibly deliver it. My phone continuously is upgrading software, which is very annoying when you're not, when your plan isn't in the country you're at. But you know, release frequency, release stabilization, cycle time, how fast are we getting stuff out? Direct evidence is what we need to aspire for. We need to start empowering, enabling, informing our development teams, our Scrum teams with this. They need to be working not in a vacuum anymore. How are they meant to adapt if we don't tell them the value of the thing they're delivering? A fellow analyst and I at Forrester Research called Jeffrey Hammond went out into the field after reading Drive, the Dan Pink book. We read it over Christmas. That was before children, so I actually did read or do anything else. We went out after reading that book because we wanted to talk to the organizations that were case studies in that book. When we talked to a lot of them, we found some things that were in common. And one thing that was really consistent with every single one of those organizations is the software development teams had a very clear idea of their goal. They had a clear idea and a feedback loop. So Netflix, we interviewed the online streaming Netflix. That was before Netflix was super popular in terms of streaming. It was still just starting. And how were they measured? They were measured on people watching streamed videos and coming back. That was a key characteristic that the Netflix organization was very interested in. They were also install time. There was all sorts of other things around the infrastructure, but generally, they knew very clearly what their measures were. And those measures need to live in context of some of the other stuff. So this direct evidence drives some circumstantial evidence. Evidence like defect density, like burndowns, like velocity, like cyclical complexity, other internal things that are very interesting. As we start to understand the relationship between direct evidence, direct stuff that adds value, and the circumstantial evidence, the stuff that really drives how we operate and instrument our systems, that allows us to improve those things, which drives improvements in measures. Now, of course, this is an experimental world. We will try things where we change the way in which we deliver, we reduce our testing. Great example of something that a lot of organizations are doing today. To increase time to market, they're reducing testing time. And in terms of user testing and UAT and those kinds of testing. But they're increasing their unit testing and their service light testing. So they're using service virtualization, there are technologies to do that, but removing the number of humans banging the software before it goes out. So what you would do is you would maybe change that. You would see the impact on revenue. You would see the impact on defects that customers are realizing. You'd see the impact on upgrades and the like. That's the kind of model that we need to put in place so that we empower Scrum teams and teams of teams to effectively deliver value. That's the kind of things that we need to think about when looking at providing measures that drive real Scrum teams so we can actually start really changing, adapting to deliver value. Okay, so we talked a little about measures and improving measures. Let's talk about professionalism. So here's an interesting question. If you went into a hospital, and it's a bargain hospital, nice and cheap, right? And the guy you're talking to was like, you went, oh, where did you go to college, man? It's a usual American thing. I don't know why they always say that, but so when you haven't got anything to ask, you say, hey, where'd you work? Where'd you go to college? Where'd you go to college? Oh, yeah, I went to Babson and did liberal arts. Okay, cool. And then you went to medical school? Oh, no, I didn't do that. I was just a natural. You know, I just came and I'm just great and I've got my tight jeans and my tight, so I'm making an analogy here. I've never really chopped anybody, but I've got such a firm grip. It's fine. If I was in that situation, I would probably say, yeah, no thanks. I want a doctor with lots of things on the wall. I want a doctor when you Google him or her, you find that they're really got lots of, they've published papers. I want a doctor that's a member of more of those three-letter, four-letter acronyms than I can fit on one business card. I don't know about you, but that's what I would. But how many people have got software engineers that you have got no idea about that? They come not necessarily from an engineering school. They haven't necessarily got the basis of experience. They haven't proven themselves. They haven't got certifications. They're not members of professional bodies. They don't attend organizations like this and take pride in their work. What do we do around that? And that's not just because we care about the quality of our software, but we also care about the productivity. These people are not as effective. Professionalism is necessary, not just because of the Volkswagen example or the Obamacare website. It's important because it helps you deliver a lot more value. A really good software engineer, a really professional software engineer, will be at least 10 times more efficient than one that isn't. 10 times. And that might be okay in India, where you can have 100 people, so you don't have to worry about that. But realistically, is it? I don't think it is. We need to focus on professionalism and industry. But when we do that, how are we effectively doing that? You know, when you form a Scrum team, who are you gonna get in it? If you had 100 developers, who would you include? Who has the skills? How do they prove they have the skills? Now, there's an interesting development in the US. I don't know if it's affecting India, but the GitHub story. The fact is, you look at their GitHub resume, you look at how many times they've posted, you look at how many things they're working on, you look at a portfolio in the same way as you look at as a craftsman's portfolio. That's interesting. But outside of their ability to build code, actually, how do you know they're going to work effectively in a team? That's an interesting question. You know, is Scrum Master certification, CST or PSM? So CSM or PSM effectively enough? Does it really make any sense? No, probably not. You probably need some more. I picked these pictures because I too have been beaten by New Zealand, and I feel your pain. So these are two very different teams. As you can see, the New Zealand rugby team, damn them. Well, what else do you do in New Zealand? Let's be frank. You play cricket or you do rugby. I mean, it is the summer there as well, which I think is a little unfair. And our English team got horribly beaten in the Rugby World Cup by the New Zealanders. So I respect your pain, guys. And unfortunately, our rugby team didn't hire the right people, and some of the skills that they looked at were not necessarily the right one, including anybody that can kick the ball, apparently. So I'm a little bitter about this. So how do we do this? We have to start thinking about building a pyramid inside your own organization, building your own expert community. One horrible, dirty fact is that you can't buy agility. You need to build it from within. Yes, you can get help. Yes, you can get coaches and mentors to help you, but you need to build your own mentors. You need to build your own coaches. Look at Lean and how Lean is implemented in most large organizations. And if you look at the Toyota story, the machine that changed the world, what you will see is they build up these competencies. They have an apprentice model. They have a mastery model. So the idea that we have consistent vocabulary, that we know what's in the backlog, that we know what Scrum means. We have shared values about honesty and integrity. We then add to that proven experiential knowledge. We then add to that our ability to really mentor. You can actually certify a coach. A coach comes in with a proven track record, their own GitHub resume, as it were, and some objective analysis that says these people are effectively professionals. Now, we're doing something. I'm not going to bore you with this. We're trying some stuff. I don't know. This isn't perfect yet. We've got some experiments in market at the moment around expert knowledge tests and intermediate knowledge tests. We're looking at foundation knowledge. And we're starting to try to build this pyramid. Scrum.org is really good at the top and really good at the bottom. And we're experimenting with some stuff in the middle to really try to help organizations improve there. Some of it will stick, some of it will probably change. But professionalism is more than knowledge. It's more than your resume in GitHub. It's about values. The reason why a doctor never ever says to you when you say, "Doctor, is it 100% certain I'm gonna live?" And the doctor will say, "Well, in this procedure, it's very safe. It's got a failure rate of 1 in 10,000. which is always scares the crap out of me. But maybe I'm like, well, hang on, what happens if there's 10,000 operations today and I'm the last one and nobody's died? Did you just kill them to keep the stat? No, apparently they don't. But they're a lot more. They have this, they swear on a Hippocratic oath, don't they? They put their hand on some religious document. I actually have no idea. Do they put it on like their bag or something? Or is it a Bible? I have no idea. Or is it their huge amount of student debt? They probably do that. I swear on all this debt that I will not kill any more people. So some values. So interestingly, this is hot off the press. So the Scrum Guide is being refreshed at the moment to include explicitly these values. Jeff and Ken, who drive the Scrum Guide, we just provide the infrastructure, are now adding these values to the Scrum Guide because they kind of got thrown out. Commitment, dedicated to delivering working software, the idea of a sprint goal, the idea that we're focused on delivering software that adds value to our customers. We're focused on what is the most important, not all the BS that you could do. Openness, we frequently inspect delivering stuff and we actually care about that. We don't pull the wool over the eyes. We actually don't deliver it. We don't do the sprint demo on our own machine. We do it on master on a VM. We do it on something that looks like production. We may even do it on production if you're really cool, but that's beyond most organizations. We respect cross-functional self-organizing team. We respect the team. We give it the ability, if you remember the new product game, we give it the ability to manage itself based on the needs that, based on a goal that we set. And we allow them to have courage. We admit we don't know everything. We don't lie to our customers or ourselves, believing that if we spend just a bit more time on these requirements, we'll build the perfect software. These values are very important to us. It's at the heart of the Agile Manifesto, and it's at the heart of Scrum. So we need professionals that demonstrate that they actually have those. Now, one great sort of practical, how do I make this real? When you're doing an interview, ask your interviewee, provide examples, but ask them to provide examples of when they've shown commitment, when they've shown focus in spite, when they've shown openness in an organization that just encourages lying, when they've shown respect for their fellow software developers and how they make that work on their teams. Ask them those questions and you'll be surprised by the answers and you'll learn a lot more about them. So we talked about measurement, we've talked a little bit about professionalism. What about done? Done, done. Dun, 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 dun. And not only does it sound like a little song, and you know, we just put a backing singers to that, we could make it really cool. It's really important, and unfortunately, we're in a bit of a mess. So we're in a mess because, you know, today we really strive to have tests, and hopefully one day with automated testing, with improvements in technology, with improvements in how we work, we're gonna get to this place. But really, we're still missing a lot of stuff. We're still missing the ability to add the operational. We're not building software that's exactly like, or is actually deployable, is almost deployable. And we're certainly not building it in an environment that provides us feedback in a business context, doesn't provide us that insight. Now, this is an idea that we've been bounding around, the idea that Scrum teams and organizations adopting Scrum build something. Now, the name is a little bit misleading. It's a Ken name, so bear with me with respect to that. I think but the idea is very insightful. The idea that not only do you provide an environment that allows Scrum, supports the values, provides education and training and mentors to facilitate it, you also start providing Scrum teams with an idea of a Scrum development kit. It's really the idea that you encapsulate the stuff you need to deliver done. You provide a development environment, you provide a definition, obviously, you provide practices done to ops infrastructure tools, you provide architectures, APIs, SDKs, you provide development standards, you basically make it easier for teams to consistently deliver done, and you build infrastructure teams or agile transformation teams or whatever you call them that help that happen. The idea that we fuel done, and this is actually being provided today with things like, you know, some of the movements of Docker, AWS, you know, their virtualization stuff, some of the new testing harnesses, some of the new development environments are allowing us to start building so you can get to that done faster. So the idea is that you would do that because ultimately what we're looking at is this idea of today we're in development, Tomorrow, maybe with DevOps, as we sprinkle DevOps into Scrum teams, is make it part of the Nexus and make it part of approaches like and Safe, obviously, and Disciplined Agile, all do this, Dad, do this. They make this very clear. But then we add measurement and agility and instrument information back into the process, and we get really done. We make this work. So we're measuring, we're becoming more professional, and we've done. If we can start doing those things in the next 20 years, we can really move us forward. But what's really interesting is how Scrum is scaling in organizations in terms of delivery. There's a weakness in the framework in regard to how people understand and apply it at scale. And I don't mean at scale in the way that Les and Dad and Safe talk about at scale. I'm talking about in scale of engineering endeavors. The fact when you have multiple teams working on an endeavor, the fact when you've got multiple teams trying to interact where there's heavy dependencies. Now, dependencies kill software projects. They really do. That's just the way it is. It's like closing time in a bar, dependencies are. They just kill the mood. And they wreck software development projects. And so how do you effectively manage that with Scrum? So let's talk a little bit about how Scrum really works today. One team doing work, nicely done. This is all the stuff they have to do that work. You know, there's code, there's specs, there's infrastructure, there's an IDE, there's all sorts of stuff. So they work on that, they cross-discipline, they resolve the dependencies between each other using insight like daily stand-ups, daily scrums, dare I say, I don't want to stand in the corner. Daily scrums, they use that by inspection, they use that with things like backlog, they work together in an effective way, it's very transparent, very open, groovy. It's definitely the best way of working. It's fabulous. And everything's going great. And you use a framework that looks a little bit like this. In fact, it looks exactly like this. This is Scrum. It works brilliantly. Product backlog, sprint planning, sprint backlog, team does funky stuff, daily Scrum, delivers an increment in that sprint review, there's a retrospective, it feeds back, we improve, maybe using EBM so the retrospective actually drives insight. You know, that's how Scrum works brilliantly. Oh dear. What happens when you've got 9 teams? Starts getting really complicated. Looks like a large blob. When you're starting getting dependencies across teams, how do you resolve those dependencies? How do you ensure that transparency that works really well when there's 7 plus or minus 2 people in an organization working in a way with a scrum master that protects them, with a product owner that makes decisions? That works brilliantly. But what happens when you've got multiple teams all stepping on each other, you know, branching from main continuously so it looks like some sort of national grid coming out? How does that work? Well, it actually becomes problematic. So about 2 years ago, Ken decided that this wasn't good enough and that the frameworks like Safe and Dad and Less weren't providing enough around the Scrum stuff. So he looked at the industry and he talked to our community, the PSTs, and talked to the community at large, and formed basically this concept of the Nexus. The Nexus is an exoskeleton to Scrum. It's still Scrum. It's just an additional set of formality around the mechanisms for multiple teams to work together. This idea, and is it perfect? I don't know. Is it being practiced? Yes. We have a number of examples because we also harvested this from people actually doing Scrum. Just because we didn't tell them in the guide how to do it with multiple teams doesn't mean that people didn't do it. So we tried to gather those best practices and bring them together, give some words to help them. For instance, Scrum of Scrums is the most misunderstood idea in the world. So we added some formality around that with the Nexus Daily Scrum. We added some formality around who cares about integration to build this potentially shippable increment, this from the Nexus, which is called the NIT, the Nexus Integration Team. We added some stuff like refinement more formally. We added the idea of a Nexus, this concept that brings everything together, but you'll notice that it's still Scrum. It looked remarkably like the other diagram. It's just an extension of a set of practices. It's simple, it's lightweight, it's a framework that extends your great use of Scrum to help you when you've got multiple teams. It removes that impediment of saying we can't deliver working software because of that team, that team, and that team. It brings those teams together in an effective way called a nexus. And it fits nicely into SAFe and DAD. It concentrates on delivery. It actually is very similar to the way less works. So the point is that it's not instead of an alternative. Don't even think of it like that. Think of it as another set of great ideas that can help us work at scale in an enterprise. It's very important. So we talked about a lot of things today. We talked about the success of Scrum, how Scrum now is used by a significant majority, how it's used throughout the world. We've talked about its success. We also talked about how it's still failing. It's still not delivering on its promise. It's not delivering on the dream that Ken and Jeff and the community around Scrum built out. It's not quite there yet. It's 21. It's done a heck of a lot, you know, and it's still wearing, and it wears long pants, and it, you know, and it could say, hello, sir, nicely, but it's not quite there yet. The idea of four things where in the next 20 years, hopefully I'm standing here looking a little bit older still, but I'll be bald, so you won't know how old I am. Bald men all look exactly the same. It's true. It's great, actually. Apart from every bald man apparently looks exactly the same, which you say, oh, you're like Yul Brynner. No, I don't, and he's dead. When I'm standing here in 20 years' time and talking about the success of Scrum, the value that Scrum is still delivering to the world, hopefully some of these things are there. Measuring the value of agile initiatives, adding that professionalism, broadening support for done, providing a practical framework for scaling that is just a natural part of Scrum, the idea of scaling. The ideas around scale are just a natural part of Scrum. Hopefully that will be what we're talking about in 20 years, and that these are just natural to delivering working software, and we're all incredibly successful. Scrum is 21 years old. Can you imagine the world 21 years ago? Flip phones. Can you imagine the world? The internet was rare, just like this hotel. Sometimes I feel like I'm 21 years old. Like, whoa, I've never seen a graphic do that. You know, when it's like downloading, I can hear somebody in the back managing an AOL account going, damn it, room 306, wants more data. What are we going to do? Phone another AOL company. Great. That'll work. But imagine the world then and how it's changed and how Agile now is just a natural way of building software. I think we're very lucky. And I think you guys are to celebrate your own success in doing that. Some of you, not all of you, because some of you look very, very young. But the older people in the room, you're the reason why Scrum has been successful. You're the reason why it is used everywhere, every day. Your success and your energy and your passion for it has driven its success into the enterprise. But we aren't done yet. You're unfortunately can't hang up your Scrum evangelist, your Scrum improvement hat and leave it at the door and sit down with a nice glass of whiskey. You have to continue the fight. You have to think about how we can effectively measure. You have to think about professionalism. You have to think about scale. You have to think about all the things that we need to do to improve it, to make it better, and you have to work with scrum.org to help make it a success. That's what I wanted to share with you today. Hopefully this has been interesting. Hopefully it's made you think about a few things. Hopefully it's not just one of these geezers that comes up here with a funny accent and talks about, I don't know, stuff. Hopefully I didn't insult you because you lost against New Zealand, a country of 3 million people and 400 million sheep. They almost outnumber you in sheep. But actually not. Interestingly, they have less sheep than you have people. But anyway, so I apologize if you are offended by that, but they beat us, so what do I know? But hopefully this has been a little bit interesting, and maybe we've got time for one or two questions that maybe I can answer, or I can use intelligent words to sound like an answer without really answering at all. Thank you. Any questions? Comments? It's 5:30, I want a gin and tonic. I know, I do too. I really do. Gentleman with the rather nice beard over there. So the question, I'll try to repeat the question. If I get it wrong, sort of shout at me. He said, the history of Scrum.org is Agile Alliance, then Scrum Alliance, and then Scrum.org. And why is certification still a key part of your business?
Yeah.
So the heart of Agile is the ability to get objective measurement of success, right? Everybody knows that. We deliver working software so we can assess it. You know, it's empirical. We assess it and we get that data and feed that back. The reason why Ken and many people in Scrum Alliance concentrated on adding this idea of assessments was to provide that feedback rapidly, to provide that objective. Now, interestingly, it was because Martin Fowler, bearded Englishman, you may know him, wrote something after a discussion on a plane flight back from, I think it was Atlanta, it might have been Dallas, with Ken. They talked about flaccid Scrum. You may have read that piece. Now, that piece drove Ken to say, hang on a minute, we need to effectively measure. Now, if you've ever been on a Ken course, you know that you get your ass handed to you pretty quickly. He continuously tests you, tests your values, tests your ability to step back from what you've been doing to apply things in a different way. Now, Ken can't be in every room, and the 150 PSTs or the 180 CSTs can't be in every room every day. So how do we effectively instrument that feedback? Well, assessments and certification are the way. It's not perfect, no. It's the step in that right direction. You know, in terms of the PSM, which about 2,500 people take every month, got some very interesting data that allows us to actually reevaluate people's understanding of Scrum. It also gives the people the ability to understand how effective their knowledge of Scrum around consistency and terms and words. It challenges and gives us feedback, gives them feedback, and then gives some sort of measure of how good they are. Is it perfect? No, it really isn't. But it's a step towards that idea of professionalism in the same way as your doctor did a hell of a lot of tests to get to the place that they're in. It's a step towards, and hopefully over the next few years, we're gonna add more levels of certification and different ways of doing it, like GitHub, like examples, like people, you know, case studies, that kind of stuff, so we can start really driving out professionalism to incentivize you. Actually, you probably don't need to be incentivized to do this, but the average developer to really invest in their knowledge and their learning, to encourage them. Now, you know, some of you have got children in this room. How many of your children wouldn't study unless there was a test? Now, maybe you guys, because you know this is Asia and you're all really cool and into learning and invented it many thousands of years ago and all that stuff, maybe that's not a problem. But my experience is most kids without that, come on, you got a test tomorrow, you better study some stuff. Now, do they learn stuff? Maybe they don't, and you have to continuously do testing and retesting and other mechanisms to add to it, but it's a start.
Yeah, but my question was somewhere related to, like, you have multiple certifications. I'm Agile practitioner, okay? In the market now I see, like, so, SAFe, LESS, DAD, then yeah. CSM, PSM. So what it makes me is, my quality of me practicing those values somewhere getting diluted, you know, in running behind these certifications.
Okay, so why are there so many? Yeah. Well, actually, doctors have even more, mate. So don't get me started on that. That's the reason why they have these really long, like PMMCQ, CSGTP. So some of it is just a natural competition to keep us true. So having you know, the Scrum Alliance versus Scrum.org, that's good because it drives sort of like trying to improve the profession around Scrum. And then there's additional skills that we can't test for everything. We can't be experts in every field. We know Scrum. We know empirical management. We know the practices of Scrum and Nexus. We understand how that works. We can test you on that. But there's some other group of people sitting over there that really know SAFe and know how that works. And they can test you on that. They can teach you, test you. They can get case studies, examples. They can drive that. They can look for different skills. Now, how many should there be? I don't know. We live in a society of chaos. You know, but hopefully over time, the markets will decide certain what's important and what isn't. But even if they don't, that aspiration, just by learning different things, by trying different things, by trying to test that knowledge, makes you better. Hopefully you've always learned something in every process of doing those certifications. It's not perfect, but it definitely steps us in the right direction. What I don't want is the SATs for software development. One ridiculously hard test that's managed by the government, a government entity that's accountable to nobody. The beauty of the most of the organizations that are doing assessment today is they are accountable. They're accountable to their members, they're accountable to their revenue, they're accountable, so it gives some level of feedback. So that's a different approach, but hopefully it works.
Yeah. Thanks. That
answered your question. That was a tricky one, don't like that. Any nice, easy questions like, how do you stay so young looking and attractive? It's hard, I'll tell you. Yoga, drinking large amounts of beer, shouting at the French and Scots. Any other questions, comments about Scrum?
I think we'll quickly wrap up. We need to set up the stage for the musical
event.
Oh, it's
time.
Yep. So okay. I'm sure you'll be around, and if Dave is around, and if people have more questions,
come and see us at the booth.
Him.
Yeah, exactly.